was a youth pastor, I was a student in the youth group. And before I was a student in the youth group, I was lost. Our family didn't go to church. We didn't really know much about God, and we certainly did not know anything about Jesus and what he had done for us. I was lost. But thankfully, there was a kid in my neighborhood who felt that God had called him to go to our neighborhood and to live out his faith towards us. And today, we're talking a little bit, we're finishing, as Mitchell said, a series called Daring Faith, in which God is calling us to grow, to learn to listen to God. So Daring Faith is not about how fast, how far you can go, how big you can create goals for your life. It's about learning, I think even more daring is learning to listen to God, hear what he wants for you, and do it. As you learned last week, to have the courage to sacrificially give generously of the resources God's entrusted to you. That takes a ton of faith. And this week, what we're going to talk about is to go in faith. To go in faith. I get so encouraged every time I'm here at Huntington. I think in part because every project is created twice. The first time a project is created, it's created mentally. You dream it up, you think it up. And this church began about 17 years ago, about the year 2000, when someone asked me to be a church planner. And I, at the time, I didn't think that was where I was called to go or be, but there was something about it that just piqued my interest. And for years, I kept praying. I couldn't shake the idea. And so this idea was kind of crafted in me, molded in me. And so it took a lot of faith to believe this. So when I became the senior pastor 8 years ago, I used to circle around the city. I drive around it. I still do. I drive around the city praying and saying, God, someday, if you would bless our church, what could we plant a second church in Huntington Beach? Now, some of you know that our church began in Huntington Beach in 1904. A small group of people in Daring Faith believed that this city needed a church. And so they started. And if you go down to Orange and Six, you can see the original building. It's the oldest church building in Huntington Beach. And so in that building, 2 years later, that's where this church began. And so it took faith. It takes faith to dream something up, but it takes daring faith to live something out. And beyond a dream, you guys felt called to come and to go and to build. And I know with your blood, sweat, and tears, this is becoming a reality. And so when I'm here, I get so excited for you because I know the incredible things that are going to happen over the years. And at some point, you're going to have these moments where you look back and you see, and you know that everything it cost you to get to this point, to get to that point, you'll look back and you'll say, it was all worth it. In fact, people will think, thank you for the sacrifice. And you'll say, sacrifice? That wasn't a sacrifice at all. It's our joy to have been able to do this, to be able to make this happen. And so I'm so excited for you. Now, when I first became a Christian in high school, I remember trying to have this kind of learn how to have a devotional life. And so I remember I was literally sitting in our living room. I had my Bible open. I was reading something that my youth leader told me to read, and I was praying. And my prayer went something like this. Lord, I'll do whatever you want me to do, but I don't want to go to Africa. Have you ever prayed something like that? Have you ever prayed something where it's like, hey, you got me. Whatever you want, except these things or except to these places, and you kind of set these conditions. So a few years later, I'm in college, and I have an opportunity to go on a mission trip to where? Of course, yes. God calls me to go to Zimbabwe, to Africa, all by myself. I'm with a team of people from other places in the United States, but no friends, no one from our church. I didn't know anyone. It was kind of a big step of faith. And for 2 months, I lived in the country of Zimbabwe, and I trained these young adults to lead these home Bible studies like our life groups. And so I got to do this. And it was the hardest thing I had ever done in my life. In fact, a month in, I was completely spent, completely burned out. Thankfully, they were smart enough. They had like a midway break. So after a month, we got to take a weekend away. We went to this place called Victoria Falls. I think there's a photo here. It's one of the seven wonders of the world, right on the border of Zimbabwe and Zambia. So I get to go see these falls. There's baboons running around. And it's kind of like, wow, this feels like Africa now. And so there's this kind of moment where I see it all, I take it all in, and I go back to this place that we're staying. And it's this one of those come to Jesus moments that you have in your life where I'm sitting down and I've been learning about covenants, that the covenants God had made with people. And so I sit down to write a covenant with God. This is one of those moments in my life where I'm going to kind of say, here's what's going to be. And so I start writing out, okay, it's a covenant between me and you, God. And here are the terms of this covenant. And I start kind of writing down, you know, here's what I'm willing to do. Here's what, and then I realized, no, whatever you want. And for the first time, it was complete surrender. It was, Lord, whatever you want, wherever you would send me, whatever you have, that's what I want. And that was the covenant that I made with God that day. It was just complete surrender of my life. And it was very interesting because I went back to Victoria Falls to that spot a little bit later in the day after I had this moment. And it was interesting. Now, I know how science works enough. I'm not a science expert, but I know how science works enough to know that when you put water in sunlight and refraction and things like that, there's rainbows, right? So if you go to Victoria Falls, you'll see rainbows everywhere. But it was the strangest moment. I don't know. You just have to think I'm weird. So as I came into this kind of clearing, I'd already been there once, seen the rainbows. But when I came into the clearing, something happened. I came into this open spot, and it was almost as if the rainbow was coming right down on top of me. I was looking for the Lucky Charms guy, thinking if I had a shovel, I would have dug right there and looked for a pot of gold. That's how, and I realized I was having one of those take your shoes off moment that God was, because I thought back to the very first covenant God ever made with someone named Noah. And the sign of the covenant was what? A rainbow. Now, people go, yeah. For me, it was a dynamic moment. In fact, there's a photo up in my office to remind me. And there have been many times where I have had to go back to that moment and say, everything, anywhere. And so you might even know when we baptize, we'll ask the question. So will you follow Jesus no matter where he leads you, no matter what it costs you? That's not just saying something about your head. It's saying something about your life and how you will follow him. And we ask that. And I think part of that is we just realize there's something about that moment in your life where you're willing to lay it all down and say, wherever you want me, however you want to use me, I'm in on this. And in that moment, I had learned what it meant to go in faith, that never again was I going to be able to try to hold myself back from the things that God wanted. Now, if you're like me, I don't know, maybe you feel like that similar moment. How many of you have on your bucket list, be a full-time missionary? I know one, okay? A couple, right? So there's a couple of you, right? And some of you are thinking through this a little bit. You know, you're thinking, well, gosh, I don't look that good in khaki, right? I just, like, the idea of that just isn't going to work for me. Well, perfectly planned, by the way. Thank you. We hit our cue perfectly there. So most of us think, you know, I'm not a missionary, but I'll get behind the Tammies and I'll support them as they feel called, right? Listen to Jesus' words. Jesus said this. It's a powerful moment. This is resurrection moment when someone walks through a wall who was dead and is standing before you. You better listen to what he's about to say to you. And Jesus says this. He said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. The word missio, where we get missionary, means to send. Okay? So, let me re-ask this question. How many of you see yourselves as full-time missionaries based on this, right? Should be all of your hands now at this point. Because what if you are a disciple of Jesus, you have been sent into the world. Now, where he sends you and how he sends you, we're going to see that the Spirit leads this. But we have all been sent by Jesus into the world. And I'm here. I was lost, but now I'm found because a high school freshman felt sent into my neighborhood. He saw himself as a missionary to my neighborhood, and we made fun of him. We mocked him. We said names I wouldn't even repeat in here because I'd be really embarrassed by what we said about him. And he endured, and he just kept coming. He had no idea that the next pastor of the church he was going to grow up in would be one of his friends that he was going to invite. And when he invited me, my first reaction was no. And my mom had already bought a ticket to the thing we were going. She's like, well, I already bought the ticket, so you're going. But I'm thankful for someone who felt that calling to go. You don't need an airplane to do this. You are sent to your coworkers, to your family, to your neighborhood, to your school, to your teammates, whatever it is, we are called. And so here's a big idea I want you to see as we're going to look at a great passage of scripture today to see this. But here's a big idea, kind of a central thought that we're going to see is that God is on a mission and he sends us out in daring faith. Today we're going to see the way that the early church first caught that vision, that they were called to live as missionaries to lost people. And the way that that began to explode, the way that Christianity began to burst out of Jerusalem. So it, as Christianity started within Jerusalem, you have this powerful Jesus movement among Jews in Jerusalem. But we're going to see a moment in which the movement goes outside of those walls. And that the people that are being brought to Jesus are people who have a much different view. They are not people who think the same, who act the same, and who were easy to reach. And we're going to see about a city called Antioch. Antioch was about 300 miles away from Jerusalem. It was the capital of Syria. It was the third largest city in the Roman world. Only Rome and Alexandria were bigger at the time. And we're going to read about these men from Cyprus and Cyrene, how they began to convert Greeks who thought a lot differently about gods and certainly God. And so today we're going to see for the first time the way that the good news is shared not only with Jews, but with Gentiles or non-Jews. The non-Jewish Greeks. So I want to invite you to turn. If you're already where we were, we're going to read it first in Acts 11, verse 19. If you want to turn to Acts 11, verse 19, page 767. And I want to show you just quickly, set the context of this as we see what begins to happen. This amazing thing that happens in the early church. And as we're going to see this, the gospel is being preached now. We're seeing this, that the church is now going outside the Jewish faith and the Jewish background. So we read in Acts 11, verse 19. Now those who had been scattered by the persecution that broke out when Stephen was killed traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, spreading the word only among Jews. Some of them, however, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, went to Antioch and began to speak to Greeks also, telling them the good news about the Lord Jesus. The Lord's hand was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. Now, what we see is there was a persecution that happened. In some ways, for years, the church had stayed in a place, and some scholars believe that maybe even God had to use persecution to kind of get them to scatter out. But you notice that even once they began to scatter out, their focus still was on Jews and helping them see that the Messiah had come, that Jesus was the Messiah they'd been waiting for, and trying to help reason with them to see those things through the scriptures. But this is the first time we see that beyond just going to the Jews, they're now going to Greeks who had a much different worldview, a much different view about gods. And they began to share with them the good news of the Lord Jesus Christ, of who he was and what he had done for them. And we see that the Lord's hand was on them, that a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. And so we see something right away, that's something I think it's important for us to embrace, that we see in these first, this church, this group of people, is that they felt called to their city. And this is our first point, is that God is calling us to go to our city. These unnamed leaders were going into their city, and beyond just Jewish believers, they were beginning to think of those who were different than them. And notice they were going to them. They weren't just waiting for them to come to them. I love a story. There's a pastor, his name's Dan Kimball. He's up in Santa Cruz. And he noticed something. He noticed that every mission trip his people got super excited for. They would plan, they'd prepare, they would put in all this energy. And he was excited one day to announce their next exotic location. They were going to go to this exotic beach community called Zirkatnas. Now, Dan, here's this group of people. They are a church in Santa Cruz, and he starts describing this beach community. There's people struggling with drugs. They're far from God. Their worldview, and people are like, yeah, let's go. Let's do this. And they're getting all fired up about going to this place, Zirkatnas. And once he let the fever pitch get as high as it could get, that's when he simply revealed that Zirkatnas is simply Santa Cruz spelt backwards. And they kind of looked at it, and his whole point was simply this, that why is it that when we think we're going far off into some exotic place, we get super excited, we'll work really hard, we'll put ourselves out on a limb for people we don't know. Why won't we put in the same effort, the same energy, the same passion for the people that are in our community? And he wanted to change the thinking of the people in his church. And God is doing the same thing here with you. This is why he has planted this church. We are called to Hakhebib Nagin Honda. That's Huntington Beach spelled backwards. That's some exotic. But you are called to Huntington Beach, California. Now, a lot of people ask me this question, especially people, my pastor friends, they ask, why did you plant a church in Huntington Beach? It seems so close. Couldn't people just drive to the Fountain Valley Church? And I'd say, well, one, it's our history. We started in Huntington Beach. Our roots are in Huntington Beach. But I also realized there was something, if you were to kind of study our church a little bit, you would realize that the vast majority of probably 80 to 90% of our church lives east of Beach Boulevard. The vast majority of Beach Point Church is Tamura, Fulton, Fountain Valley High School families. Our high school ministry, predominantly Fountain Valley High School, about 90% Fountain Valley High School. Now, I was different. I was from the other side of the tracks. Okay, I grew up behind Five Points. I went to Ocean View, but there were only a handful of us. And it was always like that when I was the youth pastor as well. There were a few Huntington students, but not many. A couple of Marina, a couple of Edison, until Carolyn Plummer came into the youth group, and she invited about 50 of her friends, and then all of a sudden it was a Huntington youth group. And then once Carolyn left, it went back to normal. But we predominantly reached Fountain Valley. And so what we know is that this is a strategic move. You've heard this, but I'll tell you again. 200,000 people living in the city, about 80% of them do not see, by their own admission, do not see themselves having a dynamic faith or involved in a dynamic way in a local church. Ken, when he went out, I mean, very brave thing to do, not a normal thing for church planters. Ken went to all the pastors, as many pastors as he can get to in Huntington Beach, and asked the question, do you even need another church in Huntington Beach? And the resounding answer again and again was yes. We're completely outnumbered. This is God's design that you're here, and God wants to use you in a dynamic way. He's going to do some incredible things, and it's not going to be easy. But as we see this first, you have to have the same kind of courage as these unnamed people who were able to say, hey, what about these people who are far? Now, here's what we don't want you to do. Don't go find all your friends who go to other churches and try to convince them that our church is better. Okay? Go find, as we see here, go find the people that are far from God. And there are plenty in Huntington Beach who are that way. I was one of those people. And I know that. We have to go to our city, to those people. Now, it's interesting that when we see something in this, these people aren't even named. We don't know anything about them. But what we do see is that there's this excitement that comes from what they do. And this is something that's kind of a biblical principle that we see in the scriptures, is that there is great excitement when lost people are found. Jesus told three stories in Luke 15, and every time he explained that when the lost are found, that there is a party that goes on, that there's a party in heaven. And so I expect us to see this in the same way, that we would want to see parties in heaven because of the things that we're doing. And there's so much excitement that we start to see in this moment. Now, for our family, this is let me show you how it works practically for us. We are a baseball family. So for 15 years, I've had two boys that have grown up playing baseball. And so what that's meant for us is I coach, but I also realize that my 8 to 15, my little social network is primarily the families that we play baseball with. And so I'm always praying, always asking, always looking for opportunities to care about them and to see what God would do. Now, I've seen this. Over the last 15 years, there's been about 30 people from our baseball teams that have been baptized, not just players, but it is extended out to family members, parents, siblings, friends of these friends. It's been incredible to see. Open up your eyes, look around to see this little world that God has put you in. And there were times where this was very hard, this was very difficult. Times where our family had to say, yeah, this is not going to be easy. Let's pray. Let's ask God for strength and let's trust him. And we would go because of that. Carl Vaders, he's a pastor in Fountain Valley. He does a lot of great writing about the church. He said this, he says, there have been too many times in history when churches have been filled while their neighborhood around them has gone to hell, in both senses of that term. God is calling us to this city, to our city. And as a result of this beginning work, the word went back to the church in Jerusalem. And so they sent a guy named Barnabas to see what was going on. There was so much excitement about what was going on in this moment. And Barnabas began to share in the joy. And one of the things that he did is he went and got this new convert. His name was Saul of Tarsus. We now know him as the Apostle Paul, but at the time he was a master theologian. He knew he had this incredible transformation, this encounter with Jesus, and he brought him in to help teach and train and lead. And what we see next is this moment that Jeff read, where the first church is going to, not only are they going to be the first church to share the gospel with outsiders, but they're going to be the first church in Antioch. They're going to be the first church to now send out people as missionaries. And so here's the second thing I want us to see as we look at the scripture again that Jeff read, and you can write this down, is that the Spirit sends us on his mission. The Spirit sends us on his mission. As we look at that passage in Acts 13, verses 1 through 3 again, listen again. Notice this unique way. Now look at these words through the filter of this point. That notice the Spirit's work. Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work which I have called them." So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. So the church is praying, they're worshiping, they're fasting, and God meets them in this. The Holy Spirit says to them, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul." Ultimately, we see it wasn't the church, it wasn't the strategists of the church. We see that it's the Holy Spirit who had placed it on their hearts, set apart for me, Barnabas and Saul. I have a special mission for them to do. Now, notice he's doing two things. He is setting Barnabas and Saul apart to be sent to where he wants, but he's also setting the other three apart for the continued mission and leadership of the city. The Spirit is our leader and is leading us in the same way. Now, some of you know exactly what this moment feels like for you. June 29th, 2014, I have never been more afraid to preach a sermon than on that day. So on that day, we were doing a series called 8 to 15 series, and on that day, we did a sermon called Multiply. And in that day, that was the day that I was going to be announcing to the church that we were going to launch Beach Point, Huntington Beach. And I didn't really know how the people were going to respond. I didn't know if they were going to be happy, sad, concerned, if I was getting fired. I didn't really know what was going to happen. So I was very, very nervous in that. And so that moment we announced, and we kind of worked it up. It was like the last point of the sermon. So try to warm them all up, get to that last point. We talked about that we were going to multiply disciples, multiply leaders, and if God leads us, and as God leads our growth, we're going to multiply Beach Point. And so we announced that next year we're going to launch Beach Point, Huntington Beach, put the photo up of the church. And to, I mean, one of the great moments of getting to be a leader, the church burst out in an applause. Some of our, we have folks in our church who are original HB folks that were, they used to go to the HB campus over on Orange and Six, and they came to me in tears. They've been waiting for this moment. And so it was this beautiful moment. And it was one of those moments where we kind of talked about, our leader will be Ken Primo and Carolyn. And everyone was like, duh, of course it's going to be Ken, you know, like it made total sense. And everyone was excited. They're cheering for them. And then I took a deep breath and I made the biggest ask I think I've ever made. And the ask was this: some of you need to be willing to go with them. And our hope and our prayer was that the Spirit would set you apart like this passage, that the Spirit would tap on you and say, hey, I know you like being on this campus with all these people, but would you, and our words to you were this, would you be willing to go be a missionary in Huntington Beach? We want you to feel just as called as Ken and Carolyn. Don't just go to fill the rows and just be supportive of Ken and Care, but when that get kind of like parents, like I would just kind of get you settled in, then we're going to head back to our house. No, dig in, give in, get in there. And some of you know, some of you, I mean, before the moment even ended, they were writing on their card, I'm in, HB, I'm going. And it's like, whoa, pray. They're like, no, I'm already going. But you guys know, some of you know this moment, you know. And I want to just affirm that moment where the Spirit set you apart for something special in this city, that you by faith would believe that God has something. And some of you, since then, you've come. And I want you to know, in these early days, you are part of something. You may not have been there on June 29th, but as you have come in and said, this is my place, you feel that sense of calling that the Spirit says, you are to be here, to be a part of this missionary fleet that I'm sending out into this city. And I want to encourage you, in this moment, let the Spirit fill your heart, even today as we were singing, that he would see this city the way Jesus sees it. There's this moment Jesus is looking over Jerusalem and he's weeping. And it says that he feels compassion for them because they're helpless and harassed like sheep without a shepherd. And I wonder what it would look like to get in a high point in the city and to look over the city and to have your, what it means when he says he feels compassion, it means he feels it in his gut. You ever felt something so deeply it made you nauseous? This is what it says, that Jesus feels that for Jerusalem. And when you let the Spirit set you apart and you really live in that and embrace that, you will feel something very similar. I don't have to try to inspire you. You will just feel sent by God. Now, some of you may feel, I'm not sure it's the Spirit sending me. I don't know if I feel called or sent. I just want to remind you of what it means really to be a disciple. Remember we saw, as the Father sent me, I'm sending you. Then Jesus said this, you're going to go into all the world. You're going to make disciples of all the nations. He said, you will be my witnesses, Jerusalem, Judea, the ends of the earth. And then I want to give you one. This one is, every time I look at it, I'm like, I'm not sure this is good. This is a good plan. 2 Corinthians 5 says this, he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. You are plan A. And there is no plan B. God is making his appeal in this city through people like us who know we are sent back into this city. Look, I if you're my age or older, it's easy to think, hey, I paid my dues. I don't really, like, I'll just be an encourager or I'll help pay for things. I love Lois Sima. Some of you are in our women's Bible, so you know her. But she's older than me. But Lois is in her 70s, and I love one of her recent prayer concerns on the prayer list was, pray for, and she had this person who's part of my 8 to 15. I was like, great pastor moment. I'll make it through the week. Like, she gets it. She hasn't given up on the people God has put in her life. You can't say you're too old. You can't say you're too young, or I'm too new. I just started this Christian thing. My friend Presley, she's a high school student. I love what she did. She brought her friend Kara, and Kara found Christ through a camp. And one of the cool things that happened with Kara is Kara, right away as a new Christian, she thought, I want someone else to experience what I experienced. And so she invited her friend Sam. And then this last winter camp, they invited Emily and Maddie. And I think I have a photo of them right here. Presley's all the way on your far right. But you can kind of see the progression of Kara and Sam and Emily and Maddie. Now, just funny story about Maddie. Maddie got recruited to play softball at a Christian college. And she's filling out her application and they're asking all these Christian questions. She's like, what in the world? Why do I have to know all this stuff? Well, now we have a little better idea of maybe why. But all these girls started with one girl feeling sent. And then Kara, who was barely a Christian, feeling like, I want the same thing that happened in my life to happen in my friend's life. And they have continued to see. They are looking. Who are their relationships? These people that are right there. These girls who are in class with them. The Holy Spirit sends you. Are you paying attention to where and to whom he's sending you? Well, here's the last thing that I want you to see. Be an ascending church costs us. It costs us. Now, it costs us, but it is worth it. It's absolutely worth it. Now, think about this moment. This was a moment of incredible sacrifice because as these leaders have gathered together to pray, Barnabas is basically like a senior pastor to them. Saul or Paul is their kind of top teacher, key theologian. It's one of those moments where you would say, boy, God, couldn't you pick two other people? Like, you've made it really inconvenient for us taking out these two really, really key people. But one of the things that we see is this kind of principle is that being ascending church will cost us. These two are just such a key part to the community, key part to the leadership, key part. This was an incredible sacrifice for the church to give these two up. But they did it because it's worth it. It's worth the mission and the bigger mission. And when God calls us to be ascending church, and that's who Beach Point is, we have to be willing to pay the cost. Now, that means for us, it's going to, anytime something costs you, it makes it uncomfortable, doesn't it? So whatever it's going to cost you, time, talent, treasure, you got to be willing to pay that. So corporately, it costs us. Our mission director, Heidi, she's in a country I can't even tell you. I'd have to kill you, okay? Or they'll kill me, okay? I can't. It's a secret place. We can't even tell you where she is. And losing her, oh man, it was like a kick in the gut. Like, it was like, I can't lose Heidi. She's too important. But for the sake of the mission, absolutely. You think it was easy to give up Ken? No, made my life really, really difficult. Do you think I wanted to give up Mitchell and Kristen? No, we were grooming Mitchell to be the next worship pastor for our church. Do you think I wanted you to have Mike D? No, we were grooming him to take over our community life position. All these people that have come over here, it's like, I mean, it's really hard, but it's right and it's good and it's worth it. I mean, if I could have made a list of who I wanted to send, it probably wouldn't have been most of you, some of you, but most of you, I wanted to keep you for myself. You're so great. Like, you made us better. But I know this is right and good. This is what makes the mission better. Personally, it's going to cost you. It costs to hang out with people who are like these folks, far from God, different view of reality, different biblical or different worldview than yours. It's not easy, and sometimes it's really frustrating. It's very scary, but we have to be willing to pay this cost. Having an 8 to 15 list, it will cost you time, energy, money, you name it, your convenience. There are going to be times where you just would like to not be with those folks, but you know it's right, it does. It costs us, and we have to be willing to pay that cost. Now, I went to Biola University, and we had a thing, and I don't know, Haley, if it's still the same, but at Biola, we would call it the Biola bubble. Do they still call it that, right? So you get caught in what's called the Biola bubble, which is you go to school at a Christian school, all your friends are Christians. You if you leave the campus, you like roll up all the windows, lock all the doors, and like go as quick as you can and get back inside the gates, because now we're safe. Woo, that was close. And I know the temptation it can be to also create the Beach Point bubble. So you're here, you're in our programs, you're doing our things, but going outside of this kind of stuff and developing relationships with people different from you, boy, that's going to take some risk. And I want to challenge you, if we're going to live as sent people, you know, your 8 to 15 list cannot be all Christian people. You're going to have people on your list, people in your life that are not Christians. And I would say, I was one of those people. Please do this for the sake of us who don't know anything. I was like those Greek Gentiles. I didn't know. And scripture says, how will they know unless someone goes, unless someone shares? How good are the feet of those who proclaim good news? How beautiful can we be those people? Rick Warren says this, the most significant thing about a church is not its seating capacity, but its sending capacity. And that's who we want to be. We want to be a sending church. We want you to see yourselves as sent people. And God willing, Beach Point Heights Beach will take off like a rocket. God will do incredible things. And guess what? We'll do it again. We'll start Beach Point Costa Mesa or whatever it is, and some of you will go. And maybe Ken goes again, and you'll be like, no, he already went once. He already paid his. But if we embrace what it means to be a sending church, we understand, hey, for the sake of the mission, for the sake of the kingdom, it's okay to pay that price. And so I want to ask you this question as we close. I want you to think about whom is God calling you to go to? I want you to think about people in your life. You know, Easter is just a few weeks away. You have this Easter card. I want you to think very specifically, is there someone that maybe God would be saying, be tapping you and say, hey, would you invite that person? Much like that kid invited me, would you invite that person to come? Who is someone that you feel called to? Your family, your friends, your coworkers. Some are sent into the city. Some are sent into the world. But who are you sent to? There will be two Easter services, 9 and 11. Okay, so there's plenty of opportunity. And I want to give you an exercise. As we close, we're going to do something. I want to give you a picture of what could happen. And I want you to try to imagine something happening. So here's what you're going to do. And as the band comes, they're going to, as they set themselves up and as they lead this first song, there are two stations on both sides of the room. And what you're going to see is there is a little cardboard cutout like this, a little silhouette. And I want you to get one. And I want you to put the name of one person that you feel sent to. And maybe that's a person you're going to invite to Easter. But I want you to take that, I want you to write their name on it. I want you to bring it back, and I want you to put it on your chair. And what I want you to do is I want you to put it on your chair, but I want you to make some room with your chair, and I want you to kind of stand in the gap between the chair next to you and that chair. I want you to stand in the gap of that person, both physically and spiritually. The prophet Ezekiel talked about, you know, I looked for someone that would stand in the gap for Israel, and I couldn't find anyone. Who would intercede? Who would stand there? Who would help them? Who would be the one that would be there? And he said, I couldn't find anyone to do that. And so during this moment, you're going to find someone. You're going to tape it to the top of your chair. There's a little piece of tape here, put on the back. Tape it to the top of your chair. And we're basically going to double this room. But it's an exercise for us to have a vision of what could happen here, of what could happen, and why God planted this church, why God's made this church. And I want you to see it and feel it. And I want you, as we sing this song, to realize that you can sing or you can pray, but that you are standing in the gap for this person. And so let's pray.